Okay, I see people have already beer, so this is a bit unfair for me, but okay. Yeah, my name is Steffen Vogtmann. I'm from Germany, and some of you may know me from the internet and from one or both of my open source tools. I created Fake, which is a F# build tool, and Paket, that's the German name of the tool, Paket, which is a dependency manager for .NET. And I have a talk about both tools tomorrow, where I give introduction, and I hope I have a surprise for you tomorrow. We will see. I hope you will join me. Ah, surprise. But today is about a different topic, and the topic is how to create mobile apps, or let's say one way to create mobile apps. And I will talk a bit about Fable, which we just had an excellent talk by Alfonso. And I will go a bit deeper into Elmish. Alfonso showed already Elmish. I will go deeper there, and I will talk a bit about React Native and React. And the idea is to show you a bit how we made this application. Our company is in Germany, and we are creating software for energy, water, and gas companies. And so we get the metadata from the devices into our system, and then we do calculation and all the invoicing for some of the energy companies. And since last year, we also have a mobile app that can run on iOS and Android. It's a React Native app. And the idea is that you basically can give it, if you're an energy company, you can give it to your workers. And the workers can go from house to house and read the meters. And also, it allows you to change meters. No, to get the data into, not to change the meter itself, but to get the data into. You can read your old meter, then you can select a new meter and a new device, and then you read a new meter, and you get a signature from the customer. So this is what the app does. And one of the important points is that everything happens offline, so the workers are going into the company in the morning, then they have Wi-Fi for a couple of seconds, the app is refreshing, and then they go out and, oh, thank you. Thank you. So they get the new information, or the request into the app, and then from this point, the app is offline, because in most situations, if you go to a customer and then you go down in the house, then you don't have internet. So this is an important point. Okay, so how can we build such an app? And just to spoiler you, I have the production code with me, and in the end, I will show you the production code so that you believe me, this is the result. So, but let's start at the beginning. And what I try to show in this talk is what I think is modern mobile app development. And one of the most important points is UI and UX. UX, so user experience. We always want to have apps that look exactly like all the other apps in the app stores. So if you create something that doesn't behave properly, then people will hate you. And so for us, we always had the idea that, look at other apps, how do they work, and then just do the same thing, but with our domain. And the second point is performance, and this is also important. If you have like this donut rotating all the time, then people will hate you again, and this is not nice. In this video, everything is a bit slow, but this is only because of the Android emulator. I can tell you in the app itself, it's super fast. Okay, so The second point is tooling. If I say modern, then I don't want like to work in Notepad. So everything that you know from IDEs or modern editors, that I want to have this as well. IntelliSense, navigation features, refactoring features, some kind, in code highlighting, and stuff like this. And since last year, since we started with doing JavaScript in some sense, I want to have hot loading. So this is, I'm coming from back-end enterprise side, so this where you always compile and then you hope things work and then you need an hour to start the app and then look what happens. And after seeing hot loading and how this works and how fast you can see feedback of your changes, I changed everything in our development pipeline. So this is one thing that you want to have. And if you're a web developer, then you basically always had this, but we haven't. So hot loading in this case is the same in React Native. So on the left side, I have a Visual Studio code editor. I am changing a bit of code, hitting save, and then on the right side, it refreshes. And so this is what I want to have, and especially for UI development, it's super productive. And you can see syntax highlighting and autocomplete and all that stuff is working. Yeah, and the last point for me is maintainability. I guess the first two points can be fulfilled with JavaScript. But if you have a bigger app, then at least for me, it's becoming a problem. So I want maintainability. And this is not only from a language standpoint, but from a complete system standpoint. I want to have a system, including a language, that guides me into the right direction, into the pit of success, and so that I have low bug rate and high maintainability. And I want something that is easy to debug. This is very important for me, especially in a situation where I'm not right next to the person that is holding the device. So this is a situation that is really hard for me to go in Visual Studio and hit a breakpoint. But I want to debug such situations. And as I said, it's not necessarily debugging in the sense of line by line, step by step, going through the app, but to understand what is the problem that the customer is having right now. And this is a question that you can ask yourself. Is the stack that you are using giving this to you? And I hope that in the end, you believe me, that this stack allows you to do this. So now let's start a bit with a small sample. And this is, the talk is about app development, but for the samples I'm using web, like internet web, and this is only because it's much easier to show and because I don't have to use the emulator. And in the end, I will show you how easy it is to go over from web development to app development on mobile devices. So this is a small counter example, a web page with two buttons, diff with the counter. And if you hit one of the buttons, then the counter goes up or down. And as you can see, we have a global variable, this one. And we can update the variable, mutate the variable, and we have update function. The update function is looking for the counter div and then directly manipulating the DOM. So this is a sample which is using two mutations, one of the global variable, and even worse, one of the DOM. So this is something that is okay for such a small sample, but if you want to go bigger, want to build a real world app, then this can be a problem. And one of the problems is that this is not modular. So if I want to, let's say, just add another counter, then I can take this code and use it as a module. I can copy the code, but then I have the problem with the like the naming of the diffs and the naming of the global variable. So I have to be very careful in this like counter string that I have to write one, and this can be a real problem. So what can we do? And here, I want to tell you a bit about the model view update architecture. Some people say it's the Elm architecture because Elm is a language that only allows you to do model view update. So they just said it's the Elm architecture, but it's fine. And the idea is that you have a model, a view, an update, and the model is your data. A view is a function that renders the data, your actual model, your current model, for instance, to HTML. Elm is like for websites, so the view function is taking the model and is rendering HTML. Then you have the user or some other component that is interacting with your website. And the user can click on a button, and whenever he or she clicks on a button, then we will emit a message. We will not mutate any global variable or local variable or something like this. We will just send messages into the system. And we will have in the background, we will have a message queue that is waiting for messages. And whenever it gets a new message, then we'll take the current model and the message, we will run it through an update function. So we have a message and model, and it will get a new model. And the new model will be displayed with the view function to the user. So you have this cycle, and there's no way back. It's always forward. This is a very good property, and we will see later why. So let's see how this could look in model view update. For this, I have F# code, but the code is very simple. So if you don't know F#, I bet you can read this. So I want to make it modular, so I use the module keyword, and I'm done. Yeah? So this model counter has a... I have a model inside this module, and this is just an integer. So I had an integer before, and I have an integer now. Then I have messages. In this case, I want to allow to increment and to decrement the counter. So I have these two messages. And to get started, I get the initial model, and this is just zero. Then I have the view function. The view function is taking a model and rendering the model. As you can see, this is not HTML. This is something different. So we don't have the angle brackets, but we have square brackets. And this is just because these are just normal F# function calls. And these functions will... The Fable compiler will transpile these functions to JavaScript code, and the JavaScript code will be React code. So this is basically, it looks like HTML, but with different brackets, but then in the end it will be HTML. And we have both buttons and a div, and inside the div we are just printing the model, which is an integer. And now the important part is that our onClick functions don't mutate any state. we don't have a global variable. We just dispatch a message. So if we click on the decrement button, then we will dispatch a decrement message. And if we click on the increment button, then we will dispatch an increment message. So no mutation happening here. And the last part is the update function. The update function is taking a message and a model and is returning a model. And it's super easy to implement right now for this part. If the message is increment, then I return a new model, new integer, which is just the old integer plus one. And if the message is a decrement, then I take return a new integer that is the old integer minus one. So this is super easy to do. Also here, no mutation happening. If I have these parts, the model, the view, and the update function, then I can stick them together. And this is where the Elmish library comes into play. It's the first time where we're actually using the Elmish library. And the Elmish library has a function, program.makeSimple, and this function is taking an init function, update function, and view function, and it's creating a program for you. So this is just gluing things together. Then I can say I want console tracing. We will see it in a minute. And I want the React renderer hooked into this. And then I can start it. And this is all you need to create a basic Elmish Fable website. I will show you a demo. Alfonso already showed you this one, but it's not not a problem. I have listed what you have to do. That's basically the same stuff that you will find in the README file, but we can use the .NET CLI to create the new template, and then we have to call yarn to install all the npm packages. We will call .NET Restore, which is using Paket in the background, a Paket 5 feature, actually, in the background to restore all the .NET dependencies because we are living in a complicated world here. And then we can start a project with .NET Fable npm run start, easiest command line that you will find. Okay, so if I take a look at this app, then this is what Alfonso showed you. We have the counter at the top, and I can go here and can send messages up and down. And in the background, you will see that if I click a button, then we see in the console that something happened. And this is, we have the console trace activated, and therefore we see the actual, the current model and the message that was dispatched. So this is, whenever the update function is running, then we will see the current model and the message that is dispatched. And this is what I mean with, I want something that is easy to debug. Because if someone, or the app, if the app sends me its current state, the app model, and the message, then I can debug it on my machine. Because all I have to do is, the app model is serializable. You can see this because it's just a JSON object. So I just need to get the current state of the application down to my machine and the current message that was sent, and then I can replay it on my own device, my own PC. And this is super important and makes it very easy. I can even use it to write a unit test. So basically, I want to unit test the update function with this. I just take the serialized model, put it into a file, and write a unit test around it so that the bug will be fixed forever. This is the place. Okay, next step. Now I want to take the counter and use it as a module. So I want to show you that this is really modular. And for this, I want to create a sample, so not only one counter, but many counters. I want to allow to add counters and to remove counters in the app. So what can I do? I have a new model, and this time the model is a list of counters, a list of counter models. And the message is I have an insert and a remove message. This is when I want to create a new counter or remove one. And I have a message called modify. And this modify message is basically a wrapper around a counter message. So as you can see, the counter list message type refers to the counter message type. And the int, so it's a combination of counter message and an integer. And the integer is basically the position in the list. So I can say, like, the second counter sent this message. And I have a init function, and in this case, the init function just calls the init function of the counter. So, and I create exactly one counter in the beginning. I could have started with zero counters, but I want to have one at the beginning. As you can see here, the type model, so the model of the counter list, is referring to the model of the counter. The messages, the counter list message, is referring to the counter message. The init function is referring to the init function of the counter. So from the counter list always down to the submodel. Let's take a look at the view. The interesting part in the beginning is the last lines. We are creating a div, and the div has two buttons, as we saw before, one for adding, one for removing counters. And then for every counter, and this is like from line 6, for every counter, we are calling the view function of the counter itself. So for the counter list, we are calling the view function of the counter, but for every counter. And we have to do something in line 11, which looks a bit ugly, but this is to wrap the current position of the counter message so that we know which counter was sending the information. And to be honest, if you use this model, and you will have the thing like line 11, you will have it everywhere. But after the second time, I tell you, you will do it always right. It's super easy. In the beginning, it looks a bit ugly, but it's super easy. And the compiler will tell you. If you're using a wrong whatever in this position, it will just scream at you. So there's no way to get it wrong. So this is one of the nice aspects of the language in this case. It's guiding me into the right direction so I can do the correct thing here. Okay, and the update function, in this case, if I want to have a new counter, then I'm calling the init function on the counter, and then this is concatenation of a list with an element. So I put the element on the front of the list, the already existing list. If I want to remove an element, then I use pattern matching on my list. It's the list. If the list is already empty, then I return the empty list. And if the list is not empty, then I can remove one element at line 13. And the last part is, if I get a message from one of the counters, then I can know the position because I was saving the position. And I know the counter message. And then I can just go through all the counters and call the update function of the counter itself with the message. This is line 18. Line 17 is like finding the correct position in the list. And line 18 is I will just send the message down to the counter itself. And then again, I change my app a bit. I'm no longer calling make simple with counter in it, counter update in counter list view, but with counter view, but with counter list update in counter list view. So one level up. I want to show this again. The important part is here. Again, the model is using the submodel. The message is using the submessage. The init is using the submodel init. The view is calling the submodel view. And the update function is of course calling line 18 the update function of the counter itself. So I have perfectly matched these 3 points. And now I have a counter list module that exposes the model, the view function, and the update function. And it can take the counter list model and put it in something larger. So this is perfectly modular. It really is. Okay, I want to show you. Always doing the wrong click. So we have the counter list sample, adding, removing, sending individual messages. And you can see in the JavaScript that we have always the messages and we have the model, and we can debug this. We can also use the Redux debugger to do time traveling. Like I said, if someone sends me the current app state and a message, then I can replay it on my machine for debugging purposes. And this is what Redux does. It just allows you to go back in time. So to do something, let's go back to this. As you can see in the background, I was going back in time. So, and I can replay stuff. I can see how the model changed between, like, before the update and after the update. So I can do this on my app and with the Redux tools. This is a really nice property. So this is what I said, modularity, model uses model, view calls view, update calls update function. And this is what really is all about this model view update architecture. This is what I showed you. And so next point is I want to talk a bit about the rendering process. So I showed you the like the F# functions diff, and then you can say put things into the diff, and so on, and it will create a huge tree of elements, and then something has to render this into HTML. So you could write a library that will manipulate the DOM to render this stuff, and this is what Facebook does. It did with React, but if you do it directly, then it will be super slow. DOM manipulations are extremely slow. So they created a virtual DOM. And the virtual DOM is just like another layer of immutable objects between my already immutable model and the DOM. And whenever I create a React view with my nice F# functions, I create it from scratch. So this is actually pretty fast. There's no problem here. Every time the app is displayed or a message comes in, it will all be recomputed. There are ways to optimize this, and we already have function in Elmish that allows you to, like, shortcut. If the model didn't change, then you don't have to re-render stuff like this. But for my app, it wasn't needed because it was already fast enough. Because React is doing something interesting, and it's not recreating the complete DOM. It's just diffing the virtual DOM. So the current virtual DOM and the last virtual DOM, and the diff will be applied as a real DOM change. And this is super fast. Actually, there are benchmarks that show that in most situations, this is faster like doing it manually. So this because the diffing is super easy, and then like not every you don't have to diff the complete tree because it's immutable. So if you find a node that is the same, like not the same object but equal, then you don't have to look down in the tree because it can't change. And so this is super fast. Okay, and now the last point to get you over to React Native. And React Native is basically exactly the same idea, but on mobile devices. And for this, we don't use HTML because we want to use the native components on the machine, on the device. And so you, at the top, you see like HTML, a div, and hi. And at the bottom, you have a control called view, and this is something that the device is giving you. There is one view on Android and one view on iOS, and React Native will call the right one, depending on which machine you are. It's also having a bridge. So like on Android, you have two threads. One is the native thread, this is in Java, and one is the JavaScript thread that is like our Elmish application running and instructing the Java thread. So if you cloning a React Native project, then you will always get like folders for Java, folders for Objective-C for iOS. So this is your application will be compiled to Java. And it will run a node process, and the node process will run your JavaScript inside your application to control the native components. But this is sounds like a lot of magic, but actually works pretty well. and it's super fast, and I couldn't believe it before, but it's true. And yeah, this is how it works. So, I showed you the left side, like the how does Elmish work? How will we generate a view? What is an update function? What is a model, and so on. And now I want to go to the right side and just go to our reproduction app. And I hope my boss will not kill me, but I won't show you domain code. This is all only the code for React Native and Elmish, so this is I hope it's a safe place. So first point. So this is the application that is actually checked out this morning. So this is real code. I have lots and lots of F-sharp files in here, and this is Visual Studio Code and with Ionite plugin, and all the nice features of Ionite are working here. And the most important point is that the model view architecture, you will find it in every file. Every file is structured the same, and the whole app is in model view update. So there's no way out. So if you open any file here, you will always find a model, update function, and at the bottom you will find, where does it start? A view function. And the difference to the counter and the counter list is that these functions are huge in some situations. The current file is for like the complete scene of a meter change. This is where we can read the old meter, select a new meter, get the signature and stuff. Basically the orchestration of this. Like the reading the old meter is a subpage, so in model view update. Reading the new meter is a subpage in model view update, and the signature is a subpage in model view update. But this is orchestration of these components, putting everything together. Also, we can take pictures of the situation and of the meters and so on. So this is a lot of stuff happening here. That's why it's so big. You will always find a message type in these files. And at the top you see like old meter message and signature message and stuff like this. This is to wrap the messages of the subcomponents. We don't have like one counter as a subcomponent, but many different sub-controls on the page. Then you have stuff like refresh, go back, which is for to handle events when navigation happens. And I can say stuff like show pictures. Then a new scene goes up where the picture selection and camera stuff is happening. So this is all the stuff that can happen on this site in this component. And then we always have like a model type. And the model type often has information about the domain. Like this is my real domain type, line 54. And I have domain code that can do stuff with such a domain model. And then I have like more properties for UI. This is nothing which is really domain logic, but I need to know on which subpage we are currently. And I need to know if the stuff is editable or not. This is cached from the domain model, but just to allow it easier in the view to do stuff. Because the view itself, the view function only gets this model. It's not allowed to like look up stuff somewhere else. Yeah, so everything that I want to display in the view has to go there. It's important because rendering depends on this information. I cannot shortcut like the view function because when I have to do like a lookup, there's no state going on anymore. So all the stuff has to go there. And then the update function here. I already showed you that this is big, but it's not complicated. And one important difference to the stuff that I showed on the slide is that in real samples, you often will find update function with slightly different signature. And here I get a message and a model, and I'm returning a model and a new command if I want. So not only a new model, but I can create new messages, basically. I can do stuff after the update function. So that's why we will create model and commands. Sometimes we don't change the model and just send new commands. Sometimes we will change the model and send no commands. And sometimes we do both. And interesting here, let's take a look at this message, save and go back. This is if someone clicks the save checkbox on the top, and then stuff has to happen. If we are not allowed to edit the page, then we return the same model, but we send a new message, and the new message is the go back message. So every time someone leaves from this scene, a go back message will be sent. And in this case, I cannot save, but I just go back. And in the other case, when I'm allowed to save, then I'm still returning the same model. And this one is interesting here. I return a new command, and this command is a promise. We are on JavaScript, so promises are made, and sometimes they are kept. And if the promise is kept, then we will send another message, and this is go back and update caches, whatever it will do. But if the promise succeeds and finishes and succeeds, then it will go to go back and update caches. No, it will not go there, but it will send a message. And if the promise runs into an exception, then the exception will be catched, and a message will be sent that is error and exception. Interesting part here is that I don't start the promise. This is basically just sending a command into the message pipeline. Dear message pipeline, whenever you are ready, please execute this promise, update request with the parameter. Please do this. And then, if the promise succeeds, send one message. If the promise fails, send another message. There's no awaiting that I do myself here. In the whole app, I don't write any await or stuff like this. This is all done by the message box. And there's no try-catch happening. It's just sending messages. And all the stuff is done by the message box. The same here at the top. This is a ordinary function call. There is a function that's called setPage, and I can give it a page number, and then some UI stuff happens. So it goes from like old meter subpage to new meter subpage. And this can succeed, then page is selected, or it can fail, then we will send the error message. No try catch happening here. I don't write try catch anymore. Okay? Another point. Not all messages are handled in this subpage on the same level. Sometimes I have messages that are just signals for a level up. So these messages are handled on a different level. So they just return model and no command. This is like do nothing, no op. But I want to signal something to the upper levels. And I will always find this information in a on a different level. Let me see this one. No. It's gone. Oh, something doesn't compile here. Oh, that's why. Yes. This is the one level up. This is the complete application and the update function of the complete application. The application update function runs and it detects, pattern matching detects, this is a meter change message. Okay, this is the right place to go in the update function. Now we're checking the submodel of the application. Are we actually on a meter change subpage? If we are on the subpage that is corresponding to the message, then we go to line 301. Now we can pattern match on the sub message. And if the sub message is a go back message, like we had at the other place, then we send a new command, and this is navigate back. And the navigate back is now one level up. So this is an application-wide message. From the sub page, I was signaling I want to go back. And on the application level, I intercept this message, and I'm signaling to the application, go back. And now something in the application has to happen. And you will find a pattern match case for this somewhere here. This is the case application-wide, something has to happen. And here you see what we do. And the interesting thing is that we maintain a navigation stack in the application. Whenever I go to a new subpage, then I'm changing the application model to register this new page entry. Because when I want to go back, I want to go to the last page and to the last page and to the last page. This is a stack that I maintain in my app model. And I can pattern match on the stack and just go back. And if it's the if the stack is empty, then I exit from the app. Signal exit app of message. Yeah, and then I will find probably something that is handling exit app messages. And in this case, we just call React Native function to kill it. Okay. So this is a way to still maintain modularity, because the sub-level is not knowing about the application-wide messages. In my first approach, I was having like a global message type, and in all the sub-modules, I was referring to the global message type. But this is breaking modularity. It was at the beginning easier, but it's breaking modularity, and this one is actually much better in practice. Okay, another important point, the compiler is your friend, and we have a compiler because we are in F-sharp world. So if you do something like this, you forget to implement a case, then the compiler is giving you a warning, and if you activate warning as errors, then it will actually not compile. And in this case, I forgot to implement the refresh message, and therefore it tells me, please do this. Please implement this message. So you can't forget cases. And this is important. Next point. In the React sample, so for web, you always have the you're always allowed to use CSS, but for a React Native, we don't have CSS. So if you want to have different look and feel, then it's a bit more complicated, and you have to do your own stuff. For us, we have like for the energy customers, we have the red theming, and for our water companies, we have blue theming. This is corporate identity, so this has to do, we have to do this here. So every time we will maintain the theme ID. The theme ID will be dispatched into all levels of the application in the view function. So the theme ID is like make it red or make it blue, and then below at the lowest level, we will pattern match on the theme ID, and whatever color you just want to display, like if you want text box color, then we pattern match on the theme ID, and then in one case we give you blue and the other red or something like this. So this is actually not complicated, and I think it's even better, at least if you are not a designer. Designers have their own ideas, but if you're like me, then this is actually good. Then, in this case, you can see we have a control Android toolbar. This is suffixed with Android. This means this control will only work on Android devices. So there is no toolbar controller on iOS. So this would only work on one platform. And you have the opposite, like, I don't know, but controls that are only working on iOS and not on Android. And actually, the React native guys are implementing more and more wrappers around this, so that you these like suffixes go away with time. But sometimes you have situations like this, and then you have to like compiler let your compiler implement this for Android and this for iOS. So then you have to like work around the situations. Okay, then, not so that I don't scare you too much, often the situation is much simpler, and you you have like a model with two properties, an update function that is basically doing nothing, refresh message that is just there to refresh, and a view function that is basically just displaying to the two properties and styling the stuff. So this is to display name and address. And since we are using name and address everywhere, like in many, many places, it's good to have it extracted as a model view update subcomponent. So this is this huge pattern matching and huge view and stuff like this is not always the case. This is basically only for orchestration. And the subviews are much nicer and simpler. Then, if you want to add menu information, like we saw it on the web page on the left side, and for the app, we have a menu drawer that is coming from the left. Then this is actually working exactly the same. Somewhere in the update, you will have a model for the menu. Somewhere in the update function, you will dispatch the update to the menu update to like do the right thing. Then you will intercept some of the messages on the application level, like show history, then you intercept this message from the menu. And so there's no difference here. It's exactly the same. And in the view, it will look exactly the same. Then this is on the application side. Everything is bound together in one huge model. So we will always have like application-wide messages. And this is the app model. And this is everything that is in your app. One model to rule them all. We have the navigation stack. We have a theme ID. We have navigation direction, because we sometimes do different things. If we can't, if like I'm going in, and then I say go back, then sometimes it skips stuff. So I want to know where I was coming from inside or outside. And then, then the submodel property is probably most important, because this is the holding information for the subpages that I'm just right now doing. And if you give me like an object of the app model and a message, then I can recreate, or if you give me an object of app model, and I can recreate the app state at this position. So this is all you have. There's no global state. I just need one object of this. No variables or stuff like this. Okay. Okay, then on the app level, I have another large update function, but it's not complicated. I can always, like, this is most complicated case that it can get, like couple of lines, and it's always pattern matching on the message, pattern matching on the model, and then it's just sending stuff down to the correct submodel. This is not complicated. And if the submodel is sending messages back, then I can intercept and do different stuff on it. It's to be honest, it's pretty boring. It's always the same. Okay, so where's number 12? Of course, I have one big view function. This is like the application view function. It's getting app model, and then depending on the submodel, I'm dispatching to the subviews. This is boring. And if I forget something here, then I get the information. So I can't get it wrong, because then the compiler complains to me, and I have to implement this. Basically, whenever I add something, a new model, then I'm just adding it in one place, and then the compiler goes crazy. Here are the places to implement. So this is easy. And the last line here is adding the wrapping, the menu around the subpage, so I can take the view from the subpage, adding a menu around it. And of course, I have like the application entry point, the AirMesh function that is taking app init, app update, and app view. And then this line here we have for like debugging on my own machine. I'm creating the console tracing that I can then debug in Visual Studio Chrome. I can actually, on my local machine, the app is running on the Android emulator, and I have Chrome. And Chrome is showing all the messages that are coming and the model changes and stuff like this. And with the latest and greatest Fable, you can also use the Redux tools to look at the time traveling stuff. And this is the only difference to the web part. This is like take the React Native renderer and not the React renderer. And then we can run the program. So this is all nice, but I have another point. shame. And I'm brutally honest here. And this is like, not everything is like looking this nice. Because when we started with React Native and F#, there was like the Fable and the React Native, which is JavaScript, but no bindings between the this. So we had to implement all the bindings so that we get the React Native APIs into our app. And for every control that we want to use, we had to create the bindings. And so like in the normal workday, I was just hacking JavaScript in untyped fashion. And in the evening, I was cleaning this up and sending it to the Fable React Native library, which is open source. And then when this pull request and release cycle was done, then I could use it in my app. So this is like the open source dog food cycle. Create shitty code by day, in the evening, fix it, bring it to open source quality, and then next day use that stuff. And this is like rest of it, where we're not finished with the cycle, and we always like put stuff there, and then this for us shame. We want to put this into the open source world to then use the cleaner model. So this is it's actually one of the benefits of using F#, because it allows you to do a lot of F# JavaScript interop very easily, but you can also just emit JavaScript with write it in a string and emit it, and the stuff will basically go to the right place into your JavaScript, and then sometime you have to clean it up and like add types and stuff around this, and this is very productive. for the current app, we basically have nothing left, only couple of helpers left for to put it on the library, and everything was like check React Native out, and then it just works. But in the beginning, this was one of the real benefits of using Fable and not like Elm, where you always hope to live in a perfect world and can't easily break out. With Fable, you can do the crazy, ugly stuff as well. Okay. Just wanted to tell you about this. Okay. So, for me, the really interesting observation really was when I looked at Elmish, that this is leading to modular design, and especially if you, there's always this people telling everyone, if you want to do UI, you have to do OOP, because OOP was invented for UI, or UI was invented for OOP, I don't know, and then it will work. But this shows that functional programming can work as well, and very well, but only if you have something like React diffing from the views, because otherwise it would be way too slow to regenerate the whole UI with every step. But the diffing is what makes it really cool. You will get very, very low bug rate. When we shipped the first version to production, we had no bugs, zero, because it's way too easy. This is just easy. We have fast development cycle. Bit of a problem is the Android emulator. This is, but this is not like Elmish fault. This is like that the emulator is shitty, and you will get really high performance UI. Okay, with this I want to thank you for coming. And check out these links. We have the Fable compiler, which is released today. Yay! Elmish. Then use Ionite for this. This stuff is not working in Visual Studio right now for some reasons. Check out React Native. If you don't want to use F#, you can use React Native directly with JavaScript if you want to. But it's a good library, really, really good. And yeah, the Gitter chat, they're really, really helpful people on the Gitter chat, and they're so responsive and so helpful. This is one of the reasons why we decided to go on the stack, is really this Gitter chat. Go there, make friends, they are awesome. Thank you.